start, I have to do an introduction. And for some of you that do not know, the person standing in front of the band right now is Mr. Nathan Shook. He's been my student teacher this fall, and he has gone above and beyond what is required as a student teacher. He was not required to start until the middle of September?
Last week of August.
You actually finished last week?
2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. And he started working with our students beginning of August, and he was there for band camp. He was there for every single football game, Wednesday night rehearsals, long 14, 15 hour days. He stayed 2 weeks later just so he could be part of the concert. He has been an amazing part of our program this year. He has been wonderful to work with. He is going to be a phenomenal music teacher after he leaves us. He's going to continue, he's going to finish up his degree at Baldwin Wallace next semester, and then he's going to find himself an awesome job somewhere. He is going to be phenomenal. As a token of appreciation, I purchased him a custom baton from Donaldson Batons. Donaldson Batons is the same gentleman who makes batons for John Williams. If you know who John Williams is, he wrote the music for Star Wars, you know, Rogue One coming up. He also wrote Jaws and Superman and all of those things. So I purchased him a custom baton for him to use. It's a very small token for all the work he's done and and as much as I appreciate everything he's done and the work he's done with our kids. On top of that, our students have also done something very special for him. And I'm going to have to hand this over to Caleb to explain this one.
As students, the band kind of, I started a calling for Mr. Shook, and it kind of just spread around the entire band, like a disease, and I'm pretty sure he hates me for it. So I decided to go to a Build-A-Bear workshop and purchase this bear that looks kind of like Mr. Shook.
Born in 1840 and died in 1893. The story for the ballet is adapted from E.T.A. Hoffman's story, The Nutcracker and the Mouse King, by way of Alexandra Dumas, Russian, adapted story, The Nutcracker. It was given its premiere in St. Petersburg on Sunday, December 18th, 1892, which this Sunday is the 124th anniversary of that premiere. I got really excited when I read that day because I thought it was going to be today, and I would have been really cool, but it wasn't, so it was awkward. The original ballet was actually a failure, but the 20-minute suite that Tchaikovsky took from the ballet music is what became extremely popular, and then throughout the 20th and 21st century is, because the music was so popular around Christmas time, people brought back the ballet, which now is performed all over the United States and throughout the world. The themes you will be hearing in this arrangement by Ed Huckabee are Overture, March, Arabian Dance, and Russian Dance. And I would just like to give a big thank you to all of you for letting me teach your kids and share my time with everyone. It's been a really great time here, and your kids are phenomenal, regardless of what you might think. I've heard a lot of horror stories of friends in student teaching, and I could not have asked asked for a better place to begin my teaching career. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
next piece we're going to play for you tonight is, when I first started reading it with the students, a couple of them said to me, "Mr. Wiley, this ain't a Christmas song." I said, "Yes, yes, it is a Christmas song." It's called "I Wonder As I Wander." And it's an interesting story about this. It's actually a folk hymn from the Appalachian area. And there was a gathering in a town, and there was a family that was running the gathering, a church gathering, and they were a very poor family, and they were running this church gathering, and they kind of bothered the people that lived in the town. So they were going to push this family out of the town and get them to go away, essentially. Because the family was living in the circle of the town, washing their clothes in the fountain and hanging them from the statues and the things of the town. So they told them to go away, but they said, "Can we hold one more gathering so we can get enough money so that we can get gas so we can drive away?" So they gave them the opportunity to have that one more gathering, but when they had that gathering, it just happened that there was an ethnomusicologist in town that wrote this little statement. He said, "A girl had stepped out to the edge of a little platform attached to the automobile. She began to sing. Her clothes were unbelievably dirty and ragged, and she, too, was unwashed. Her ash blonde hair hung down in long skeins. But best of all, she was beautiful, and in her untutored way, she could sing. She smiled as she sang, smiled rather sadly, and sang only a single line of a song. And every time she would sing the song, someone would pay her a quarter. And this man was so enthralled with this song that he paid her a quarter after a quarter after a quarter. And I believe he had her sing it about 20 times, pay her a quarter every single time she sang it, just so he could write every single note down as he listened, so that he could document it and rewrite it so he could share it with other people." That song is "I Wonder As I Wander." We hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
next piece we're going to play, although not a recognizable name, a childhood hymn, it will be a very recognizable song. Little known, this folk tune that this was based, or this folk hymn that this was based on, came from a book. The book is called Say and Seal, that was published in 1860 by novelist Anna Bartlett Warner. The story of this is not what many people originally think. The story is actually of two adults, and in the story itself, in the chapter, they're labeled as teachers. And these teachers are caring for a dying child. And they've called the doctor in, and the doctor's come in and has given the proclamation that there is nothing more we can do. We cannot help this child anymore. All you can do is make them comfortable and stay with them to the end. So what the male teacher picks up the child and holds him in his arms and walks across the room and paces back and forth as the sun comes in through the window. And as he's pacing back and forth, he recites the poem that this will be based on. The poem was, Jesus loves me, this I know, or the Bible tells me so. Many people don't know it came from the book Say and Seal, but many of us know the children's tune. This is a very powerful piece because it has so much symbolism as they're comforting the child and saying, you know, although you are ready to die, there is a place for you. You will be able to be at peace and out of pain. So we hope you enjoy this version from the book Say and Seal, and we hope you enjoy a childhood hymn.
Thank you.
and some stories are so timely. Just this earlier this week, many of you probably saw the video of the Santa Claus and the dying child. That really hit me this week as I watched that video and I knew the backstory of a childhood hymn and the Santa Claus that was at a child's deathbed and was able to give him his final wish. So I really wanted to make sure we shared that piece with you tonight. But in order to fully understand happiness, you have to very much understand sadness. So to close out, I would not close out on such a somber mood. I'm going to end with a very, very fun piece based on a opera, Carmen by Bizet. This is a fun piece that we've taken a little bit of Carmen and a little bit of Christmas music, smashed them all together, and just had a lot of fun. We hope you enjoy a Carmen Christmas.
Thank you. First of all, I see a lot of alumni out there, and now is your time to shine. So I'm seeing parents pointing at you, if you go up, if you don't come up, I will come get you and pull you up. I see lots of you all over the place. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Come on down, we got some in the balcony. I know there's a lot more alumni out there, come on. Young, the old, you're all part of it. You're all considered alumni, come on. Ty, I see you up there, let's go. You have everyone pointing at you. I'm gonna come get you personally and drag you up here. So, little old me is gonna drag you down. All right, in the meantime, I got choir booster parents coming over.
Go Sue and Maddie!
And let me have Maddie and Hope Caruso come on down. Maddie, Hope, Nicholas Squires. How many baskets we gotta pull? We gotta pull quite a few, right? All right, where's Nick Squires? Come on, Nick, you wanted this, let's go. Thank you, alumni. Raise your hand, sopranos are over here, altos are over here, tenors are over here, basses are here. Find who you need to be by. All right, so what are we doing first, ladies? Okay, what is this? This is for the cute snowman. How cute is he? I'm a huge snowman fanatic, if you couldn't tell. So here we go, Maddie, pick the snowman right here. And this goes to 722058. 722058. Hi. Hi. Drum rolls. Thank you. And it is 721997. 721997. And Mr. Squires!
This will be for third place, which is $150. Mel Saylor.
And the seller is Liz DeWitt. Liz, you get some moolah, lady. Woo woo! All right. Brilliant. Yep. Okay, so that's 150. Come back, Maddie. Your turn next. Come on, we're not done. Yeah.
Okay, this prize is for $350 going to Colleen Dalton. Woo, Colleen! Oh, the seller is, where's the name? Oh, Gavin Markle.
$500.
Jen Kilby? And the seller is Ben Brighton.
Good ladies? Okay, I'm gonna pass this off to Mr. Wiley.
Birthday boy.
Okay, we're gonna close the program. Ms. Johnson asks me to read this every year. We're gonna close the program with the Hallelujah Chorus. The Hallelujah Chorus is best known and most dramatic section from The Messiah, an oratorio first performed in Dublin in 1742 with the composer conducting. In addition to the chorus, the original orchestration calls for two oboes, two bassoons, two horns, timpanis, strings, and keyboard instruments. You see, we've grown a little. King George III, in attendance at the premiere performance, is said to have suddenly leapt to his feet on hearing the opening chords. Historians disagree, however, as to whether His Majesty was merely showing his appreciation of the music, or whether, as the story goes, he had been startled out of a sound sleep. Whichever, the entire audience followed the regal example, thereby instituting a tradition which has persisted for more than two centuries. Even today, it is customary for an audience to rise during the performance of this exciting work. So if you were able to, please rise.
Let's hear for our amazing accompanist, Miss Nina.